So we saw that the vacuum equations, vacuum Maxwell equations, give rise to wave-like solutions, but what we haven't seen yet is what exactly are the properties of these waves and how can we describe them. And so taking this simplest form of the solution, so this these sinusoidal waves for the electric and for the magnetic field, if we take these expressions and we get them back in Maxwell's equations, so if we take the form of these equations and plug them back in the vacuum equations, what we get are relations between the vectors and between the wavelength and the frequency and so on between omega and k. Now, we will not do this here thoroughly. You can look at the supplementary material for a step-by-step derivation of all the properties, but what we learn for an electromagnetic wave is that it is actually a transverse wave. What we get is an expression that relates the wave vector, the electric field, and the magnetic field. And the relation between the three is a vector product. And as you may recall, a vector product can actually be given in terms of a right-hand rule. So if you have your right hand and if you get your fingers in a way that they're orthogonal to each other, if this is the first, if your index finger is the first vector of the tree and your middle finger is the second, then your thumb is pointing towards their vector product, as you can see on the slide. And so this right-hand rule tells us that any three vectors related by a vector product, so in this case, k vector product e gives us omega b, any such three vectors are mutually orthogonal, which means that k, which is the direction of propagation, is orthogonal both to the electric and the magnetic field. And the electric and magnetic field themselves are also mutually orthogonal. And so all three of them form what is known as a right triplet. So they all are orthogonal to each other, and so they form, if you like, a square base. Now, what does this tell us? This tells us that the electric and the magnetic field are always in two planes which are orthogonal to each other. So if you have the electric field in one, the magnetic will be in the one perpendicular to it, and furthermore, that they are both oscillating orthogonally to the direction of motion. Now, waves like this are known as transverse waves. So unlike the longitudinal waves, in which case the direction of motion is the same as the direction of oscillation, so the oscillating is in the same direction as the motion, for transverse wave, the direction of oscillation is orthogonal to the direction of motion. And so electromagnetic waves are transverse waves. Why is this important and what does this give us? Well, at this point, we can actually define something very central to antennas and to power of electromagnetic waves, and this is the pointing vector. Now, it turns out that if we take this cross product, so E cross B, what we end up with is a vector which points in the direction of propagation, and if we take this mu zero constant and divide the expression, the new vector which we have formed, which we have denoted as P here, the pointing vector, has the meaning of power flux. And what does power flux mean, we're going to see shortly, but what this tells us is that the electromagnetic wave, as it propagates, first of all, the electric and the magnetic field are mutually orthogonal, they're orthogonal to the direction of motion, and the energy they traverse with is also orthogonal to them. So the energy is directed in the direction of motion, while the electric and magnetic fields are orthogonal to it. So what is the most fundamental definition of energy flux and of power flux? Well, energy density, which we're going to start with, is, as the name suggests, the energy per unit volume. Whereas power flux is actually the power that passes through a unit surface. And so how are the two related? Well, if you think of the units in which they're measured, power flux is the energy passing per unit time, per unit area, leaving or entering whatever area we're considering, whereas the energy density is simply the total energy inside whatever we're considering, whatever object, divided by the total volume. And so there is a very nice connection between the two, since any energy leaving or entering, for example, if we consider a closed surface, a sphere, any energy which is entering or leaving the surface must come through its surface. So if we have a total energy density inside of this sphere, if some energy leaves, then the energy density will become lower because there will be less energy on the same volume. On the other hand, if some energy flows in, then there will be more energy density since we have more energy for the same volume. And the connection between the two, since the only way for energy to enter or exit the sphere is through its surface, the relation between the two is given in this integral formula, which might look a bit scary at first, but it has nothing really so bad about it. So the integral on the right, which is the pointing vector integrated over the whole surface, gives us the total power flux for the whole area. So it gives us the total energy per unit time that passes through the surface. And of course, all the energy that passes per unit time must be equal in some way, up to a sign convention, to the total change in the energy inside. And so you can see that the total change in time of the whole energy inside, which is simply a volume integral of the energy density, gives us exactly this integral, which is the power flux, which uses the pointing vector to be computed. And so the pointing vector is one very important quantity in the sense that if we have the general electric and magnetic field, which is traveling, if we have an electromagnetic wave, for example, we can immediately compute how much power will be passing through any surface area which is parallel to it. And just to consider the simplest case of area which is parallel to our free traveling wave, we can look at the following slide, which takes exactly that, the magnitude of the pointing vector. So in general, the pointing vector, again, is a vector, it has a direction, and so depending on what the angle between it and the surface it passes is, the different amount of power will traverse the surface. But if it is precisely orthogonal to that surface, then its magnitude gives us the power that passes through it. And the magnitude of the pointing vector is essentially the magnitude of this vector product. And so if we compute what the electric field or the magnetic field is for those waves which we considered earlier on, the sine waves, what we get is the following expression. So it can be expressed in terms of only the electric field or only the magnetic field, since the two are related. Now something very important with these constants is that if we take mu and epsilon from the relation which turns out to hold, if we want to have electromagnetic waves, if we want these sine functions to be solutions to Maxwell's equations, we see that there is a certain relationship between the speed of the waves and those two constants. And we see that c squared, which is the speed of the waves squared, should be equal to 1 divided by the multiplication of those two constants. And this is something very crucial. This is something which the first person to realize was actually James Clerk Maxwell, and he was the one to realize that light is electromagnetic waves, since he computed these equations, he got the vacuum solutions, he saw that they're wave solutions, and he computed the speed at which the waves must be traveling. He had no clue at that time that light is an electromagnetic wave, in fact no one knew, but the speed of light was well measured. And so by comparing those two constants, which are very well known, by comparing this ratio, 1 divided by epsilon 0 mu 0, with what was experimentally known to be the speed of light, he concluded that the two are very, very similar and it was too much of a coincidence to overlook. So he concluded that light must be electromagnetic waves, and in fact was the first to realize this. Now, we do know that light is electromagnetic wave, but we generally consider all possible waves at this point. We're soon going to restrict ourselves to just a smaller part of the whole spectrum, a small band of frequencies, if you like, which we know as the radio frequencies, the microwave frequencies, and these are the ones which we practically use for communication, but the general description of electromagnetic waves does not really depend on the frequency itself. Continuing on, you see that the power flux is something very important, since if we have an antenna, if it's emitting with a given frequency, with a given amplitude, what we can get from the pointing vector is how this power is distributed and how this power will be accepted. Like if we had an antenna emitting and if we had a different antenna receiving a different point, the pointing vector at the receiving end would actually give us the power flux that our receiving antenna would be seeing. And so we immediately see, since the power flux was defined as the power per unit surface, we immediately conclude that an antenna would have to have some surface, maybe not physical surface, but effective surface, since to gather that power, to receive power, it will have to take in the pointing vector and all the power it collects will actually be proportional to its surface and the pointing vector at that point. And so even here we can anticipate that the antenna will, its, or its power will depend on its surface area in some sense. Now, before concluding this part, it is very important to make a very general distinction between electromagnetic waves in general and the vacuum solutions which we saw right now, so the free electromagnetic waves. Now, real electromagnetic waves are never free. They're never sinusoidal waves alone, simply because a sinusoidal wave is infinite in both space and time. So these simple solutions which we just saw and which we just described are a very good approximation for a wave which is very far from the source, since if you imagine a source emitting waves in their concentric spheres, very far from the source, those spheres, they look almost flat. And so we can consider that a wave very far from its emitter is almost a plane wave, but in reality, we never really have plane waves. And we're going to see in a few sections that real waves are a bit harder to describe in terms of how they're emitted, how they're received, and there is something which we will see is a loss of the power as they propagate. So free electromagnetic waves, they're infinite, they have no loss of power, and they're a mathematical idealism which allows us to describe general waves a bit easier. But real electromagnetic waves, as we're going to see, have power and their pointing vector depends on the distance they traverse. And so in such a sense, they will lose power density as they go further from their source.